Well, good afternoon slash evening, everybody. It looks like we've got a fair number of attendees and wanted to get started on time, but appreciate everybody for joining this afternoon's webinar. It's been a while since ASA's had a webinar for our membership and commercial clients. And so it's kind of always a pleasure and a fun time to get in front of you folks to help visit about some of our programs and projects. Tonight we're talking Carcass Merit Program, one of the longest running projects at the American Simmental Association, I think. I can safely say that. And wanted to introduce our team and kind of get you folks more familiar with our various carcass efforts and how it's influencing you as producers. So I'm just going to start very quickly with a quick introduction. I've got a couple of our ASA team members on tonight to help visit about this topic and more specifically introduce Susan Russell, who is our new coordinator of the Carcass Merit Program. So let's see if we can switch these slides. So here is the ASA Carcass team. And so, you know, as a group, we're responsible for data entering, getting carcass data entered into herd book, and also visiting with, you know, commercial herds and seed stock folks alike. And so Jannine Story, who is on the call, and she's gonna visit with you folks later on about THE and some of the specifics of getting carcass data into the evaluation. And so I'll let her kind of introduce herself at that point, but she's been a long time staff member at the American Simmental Association and really does a lot of work in our total herd enrollment and carcass programs, along with Amber, who also is involved in THE and carcass data entry. So we work a lot with them on making sure that the data is clean and gets in effectively. Like I said earlier, Susan Russell, who was just brought on, she is our new Carcass Merit Program Coordinator. And she actually comes from a seed stock background. She is an ASA member, and they're running a couple hundred head of cattle here in Colorado. But Susan's been a wonderful addition to our sim specialist team, and is very familiar with the American Simmental Association. Past board member, I believe, as well, Susan, right, for 6 years. She and her husband also received the Golden Book Award. And so a long-staying member of the American Simmental Association, does quite a bit for our association, and we're really, really, really happy to have her on the Carcass Merit Program to interface much more with our nominators and our members, as well as the cooperator herds that we work with. And so I don't know if either of you guys have anything to add, but otherwise this afternoon I want to just visit about the reasons why we're so invested, why ASA is so invested in carcass as a trait for data collection, as well as how it's improving and the different efforts. So with that, I'm just gonna kind of visit briefly about why carcass data matters. And so this graph illustrates the importance of carcass data. Because if we look at the reflection of carcass data as a piece of data entering our eval, it is far and away the rarest form of phenotypic information. We get a lot of pedigree information, a lot of birth weight and weaning weight data. But in the IGS database, which is the genetic evaluation that serves American Simmental Association, carcass data is the rarest. And so if we think about the genetic evaluation as a steam engine, and it, you know, every week we're getting new records uploaded constantly, thousands and thousands of data points entering constantly. We can't rely on data from years past to continue to fuel the genetic predictions of our young animals. And so if we think about how IGS is constantly moving forward as a genetic evaluation, we need to constantly feed that engine data to help increase the performance of those predictions and the accuracy of those predictions, but make sure that we're staying current with our genetic predictions as well. And so carcass is one of those extremely important areas of effort for that genetic evaluation. The Carcass Merit Program was established in the late 90s, I believe, when Jerry Lipsey was the EVP of the association. And this is a quote taken out of the Simmental's American Journey book with Dr. Michael Dykeman. And many of you, I think, have visited with Michael before, and he's also one of our sim specialists, but he spent a considerable amount of time working on carcass data and understands its importance, and so really is a good advocate for the program. And the CMP has been in operation for very many years in terms of longevity of young sire progeny tests. Very few groups still have an option for members to enroll their young sires and get them tested in commercial herds. So this is just a graph that illustrates the carcass data reported by year. And yeah, you can see that when the CMP first launched in the late 90s, we saw a noticeable improvement in the number of carcass data being reported per year. And so in 1999, we had over 1,000. And for a while there, it was a consistent contributor of carcass data and averaged a couple, 100 head a year. And along with the Carcass Merit Program also comes the awareness of the value of carcass data. And so not only did it have a direct influence in carcass data coming into the eval, it also had some pull through by folks understanding the importance of it. But we noticed in 2018-ish timeframe, it was like right when I first started at the American Simmental Association, that the genomic panels that we were using weren't catching up in terms of their effectiveness on carcass traits in relation to the growth traits. And so we put extra effort and doubled down on carcass data collection in 2018. And I'll visit with you folks about that here in a little bit. And so Susan, I'm hoping that if I miss something, that you can pipe in and help cover some of the specifics of the Carcass Merit Program. But really, everyone, the Carcass Merit Program serves both the American Simmental Association members, and then their members as customers. And we work with a really good group of commercial herds that are using these bulls in their programs. And so for our cooperators, they get a swath of really good benefits by just being associated in the program and using these bulls. All of our cooperators sign on and they agree to help report and collect data on all their calves. And so they become directly engaged in genetic evaluation. And so they do the same types of tasks in terms of data recording as ASA members. I mean, essentially they are ASA members, but they're cooperators at heart. And so they get free genetic evaluation. And so that would be our total herd enrollment option C side of things. And so a lot of folks are using that to get EPDs, and our cooperators get that for free. And usually, so Susan and I's role in this is, right around this time frame, we're out recruiting CMP bulls and visiting with members. And so we try to put together a pretty robust list of young bulls who are range from being percentage bulls to purebreds, who are red, homozygous black, who have varying pedigrees, differences in EPD profile. We try to find a really diverse group of high-end elite young sires. And so that list is what our CMP cooperators get to choose from every spring. And I'll show a list from last year just to help you guys get a better picture of that. And the semen is free. And so you don't have to pay for any of that. The semen is volunteered for the program by the nominators. And so you get free semen on some of the industry's best Simmental and genetic bulls. We also pay you $60 per calf, and that can be bumped up to $65 if we can get the carcass aided in a pretty timely fashion. And so every calf sired by those CMP bulls, you get paid for when we get the individual carcass aided. So that's the incentive. Our threshold is so high in this program that carcass data is the core function of why we're doing this. A lot of other young sire progeny tests, they just focus on getting growth data or feed intake or anything along those lines. But carcass data has proven to be so difficult to capture that we set that threshold very high. And so we incentivize that to the best of our ability. We also genotype all of the terminal calves, both the CMP sired calves as well as the natural service calves that you would have on your place. So if you're going to feed a group of steer calves, you know, in the fall, we're not just going to genotype the ones out of the CMP bulls. We're going to genotype the whole group. One, that helps us get a better contemporary group comparison. But secondly, it helps us build a better understanding of your herd's genetics. And so those genotypes will flow directly into your cow herd because you're on free genetic evaluation. And then you get the flexibility to retain, you know, any and all of those females. You can do whatever you wish with them. I know a couple of our cooperators that we work with right now have a female sale, and you leverage the high-end nature of the bulls that they're using to help sell some females. And so that is your choice to do, because we definitely recognize that our CMP herds that are our cooperators are it's your operation, and we're just trying to help in any way that we can and create a pretty symbiotic relationship. And so we visit a little bit about our nominators. And so for folks that are tuning in who are ASA members and who might have one of those bulls that might be a good fit, I think consider the nominator process. So the cost is $1,500 per bull, and you provide 100 straws of semen. But what we guarantee is that we will test those bulls in multiple commercial herds throughout the country, and we will capture as much data as possible. We asked all of our cooperators to collect growth data and maternal female metrics. We're helping them capture genomics. And so you'll get genomics on terminal calves that'll feed directly into the evaluation of that young bull and your entire cow herd, right? And the nature of some of these traits, so like carcass data, if you have a young bull at 1 year of age or 2 years of age, you can genotype them and get some increase in accuracy. But if you've got years worth of carcass data in your cow herd just by association of the CMP, you can add accuracy of genetic prediction for those carcass traits even more above just doing genomics alone. And so there's a couple examples of that. And I don't have that in the presentation today, but we are noticing that if you've got historical carcass data flowing into your herd, it does increase prediction by a substantial amount. And we talked about having our threshold set super high. We guarantee that you will get 12 carcass records or 12 independent carcass records on calves out of your bull. More often than not, we get more. And sometimes we get fewer. And the reason for that is the very volatile nature in getting carcass data. You know, COVID this last year has prevented us from getting into packing plants to collect individual data. We've had shipping errors, feedlot errors. And so sometimes, you know, we recognize that there's going to be times where we don't get as much carcass data on your bulls. And if that's the case, we do reimburse that nomination fee. And lately what we've been doing as another perk for our nominators is those bulls that come in, we provide a complimentary F250K high density genotyping panel or a low pass sequencing test, which is an R&D type process of gathering higher sequencing data on these bulls. We also recognize them in our ASA publication. And so this is kind of what those ads look like. We've been doing this now for a couple years where every new issue of our publication, we are showcasing a new bull or one of the sires in our CMP class. And so usually these are pretty prominent in our publication, and I sure hope that our folks appreciate it. And that's at no charge to the nominators. And we talked about the list of those bulls. And so for some of you that may be tuning in that are interested as a cooperator, this is a list from 2021 of our CMP sires. And so, you know, they range from purebred Simmental bulls to percentages. More often than not, they're homo polled and homo black, but we do get some red bulls, and we definitely try to accommodate that. And so that's certainly something that we're open to having, and Susan will probably back me up on it. If you've got a red Simmental herd, or you want to add more red genetics into your herd, we are more than willing to go out and help try to find some of the best red bulls in the country and bring them into the program. And so this is what those lists look like. And certainly these are some of the bigger names of young sires in the Simmental industry. And so I'm just gonna revisit back, because we talked about the research side of things, and really that's where my role is going to evolve, is continually focusing on the research side of our carcass predictions and how do we improve prediction for these traits. And so we, you'll notice in 2018, we launched the Carcass Expansion Project, which was to be a symbiotic and add-on research project to fit with our Carcass Merit Program. And this is what allows us to genotype all of those terminal calves with data. And so you'll notice right when we launched the CXP, we saw a huge spike in the number of carcass records, but also DNA submissions as well. And so 2019 would be the big year. And I haven't updated this graph in a little while yet, but so 2020, right? So it would be reported by year reported. And when I first did this, I think it was early 2020. So 2019 would be the year where we had a lot of animals with carcass data that we genotyped. I think there was a couple thousand there. And Jannine just told me today that we've got, I think it was 1,800 or 1,600 samples going to the lab of animals with carcass data and genotyping. So this is the big reason for that. Our progeny equivalents, and so what that means is for the animals that you genotype, if you genotype a yearling bull who has low accuracy and no progeny, if you genotype him, what is the resulting increase in accuracy for varying traits? What is the equivalent to how many progeny he would have at that level? And so if we would genotype that yearling bull, it would be like he has had 11 progeny with back fat records. And so that's how you interpret that. And it shows the worth and the value of our genomic panels. And you'll notice that from 2012 to 2020, we have drastically improved our carcass weight progeny equivalents, but these are nowhere near close to the level of the growth traits. So for birth weight and weaning weight, you'll see plus 25 or greater than that number of progeny equivalent for those traits. And so our goal is to get the get these, up to speed and really help the genomic power of our tests and our predictions. And how this also helps is, even though, so as we increase the number of carcass records reported, and as we increase the number of animals with carcass data and genomics, that improves the prediction of every single user in our genetic evaluations, carcass predictions, as well as if they do genomics. And so everybody benefits by a handful of folks submitting carcass data. Now, we certainly would like more folks to be submitting carcass data, but it's one of those traits where everybody's going to benefit. And so that's what the CXP has allowed us to do. And just as a quick plug, because it's pretty symbiotic with our CNP, the Carcass Expansion Project is open to all of our C-Stock members and their bull buying customers. And folks can enroll terminal calves, and we'll provide TSUs, and ASA will pay for the genotyping expense. And so that's basically where I'm at with the CMP, and I know Janine's got some slides dialed up as well, but Susan, do you have any comments or would like to add anything before we go to Janine?
Got a great lineup of bulls coming in the new class, and we're still looking for some more. So I think it should be good for the cooperators that are on the call. I think Julia and John are on here, and probably some others that I think they'll be excited to see some of the offerings we've got from membership for them to select for their herd. And we're, of course, still always looking for cooperators as well.
Susan, how many new sires do you have thus far going into March nominated?
I think there's probably 10 on the list at this point.
Awesome. Very cool. Jannine, I'm going to dial up your slides. I'll let you introduce yourself.
Okay. So my name is Jannine Story. I've been with ASA for a number of years. I've had the privilege of working with the Carcass Merit Herd for almost the whole time I've been with ASA. And so one of the things that I've spent a lot of time with is helping fine tune this data and to help new commercial herds bring their herds into the database. And so my part of this presentation will really talk to those who may be on this call that are thinking about whether they have the herd for the program. And so the means for us to collect this data is obviously through our total herd enrollment program. So if you want to switch slides, Lane. Okay, so one of the biggest things for our carcass merit herds is some of the requirements. One, to hold an adult membership. We've got the contract that was shown on one of the other screens. And it's more just to help you be aware of what's required and what we really need to make this program be successful. Submitting data digitally, online or spreadsheet format is the best way to do it. We need individual calf records. We can't, we don't want average group birth dates, things like that. We really want individual calf records, birth, weaning, yearling weights. All of that gives us the details that we need with the carcass records. And then individual carcass records. Sometimes we'll have people say, well, can I just give you an average? We actually need the individual records per animal to be able to link to that ASA number, that entity in our database. And the next one. So what kind of data is required? We will create a unique entity for every one of your dams. And so if you've got a herd that you know some pedigree, we can build that. If you just have a commercial dam you don't know a lot about, we'll have a beginning point. each year we need a calf record that we report so that that dam has a calf record every year. Again, birth, weaning, yearling data should be collected. Each calf will be given a unique tag, tattoo number, ID in our database. And then every calf that's sired by a Carcass Merit sire needs an individual carcass record. And again, we understand when a tag is lost or something like that happens when they're in the feed yard or in the kill plant, but for the most part, that we do require that. So the best way for us to collect all this data is through our total herd enrollment program. It's the best way to be able to keep track of every single cow, to be able to link a calf record to every single cow. We have what we call productivity codes. If she's enrolled and she doesn't have a calf, why not? What happened? Was it stillborn, aborted? So there's different things that allows us to keep a current record on each dam. Submitting that calf data, we start to build pedigrees. Pretty soon as you start selecting replacement heifers, because with the Carcass Merit sires, you're allowed to retain the heifers, you start building pedigrees pretty quickly. We want the most complete contemporary group reporting of your calf crop. And so we want all the dams enrolled. If we've had some herds that don't use their whole herd to be used with the Carcass Merit sires, but they've learned to report all the calf data because it allows the whole group to racial rank against each other. And so there's a real benefit for them because like Lane mentioned earlier, and I'll talk about it here a little bit, you get some data back for free for that for your herd. And so let's go to the next slide because it'll talk about some of those things. So we have two calving seasons. We've got spring calving, that's anything from January 1st to June 30th, fall calving, July 1st to December 31st. You certainly want to, pick the season that best fits your herd. We realize you'll have some a little early, a little late, things like that. With our program, we want you to submit an inventory every year that tells us what dams are going to be calving. So for our spring enrollment, we enroll just prior to that calving season. And so it gives you time to be able to tell cull dams that left the herd, to tell us who's active, to if there's replacement heifers, or if there's heifers from two, that are coming 2 years of age that you didn't retain, again, to be able to get those out of the herd. And so, and the same thing goes for the fall. You've got that 2 month window to do that. Next. So then it comes down to costs. What is it going to cost you to participate as a Carcass Merit herd? You've got your membership with ASA. Your first year is $160, and then each year thereafter, it's $110. Option C is the payment option under our total herd enrollment umbrella. For commercial herds that are not a CMP herd, they pay $7.50 per dam. Whereas the CMP herds that participate, you get that for free. And what it will do is give you EPDs on every single calf that's reported. And so it's a real benefit, especially like I said, for those herds that might use part of their dams for the Carcass Merit, but they enroll their whole herd, they get it on their whole herd at that no charge for that $750. We'll help you set up your cow herd free of charge. We'll walk you through how to do it. We've got spreadsheets. We've got different ways that we can do that. And we will assist you and work with you and get those records as complete as possible. And then once calf records are submitted from the CMP sires, we've linked carcass records to them. You have the potential of getting paid $65 per carcass record if we can get that within that first month after the animal has been killed. If we can get that turnaround quickly, you have the potential to get a little bit more payment back on that. So how do you submit data? And there's several different ways we can do it. We have online, where you can actually just use the software that comes with your membership, where you can submit data through Herdbook. You can enter data into a spreadsheet template, and it can be uploaded into Herdbook. If you use CattleMax or CowSense, there's a way you can import data from that software right into Herdbook. So we've tried to make it as easy as possible. And in all carcass records, once you get them back from the kill plant, all of those need to be sent to CARC data for ASA to enter those. Those you're not responsible to enter. We do ask for your assistance in matching up ID records, the ID of the animal to the carcass records. And once we have that, then we'll take care of it from there. And then after that, then we're able to calculate payments back to everybody. So that's just kind of it in a nutshell for the data submission side of things. If anybody has questions, certainly feel free and ask. The floor is open, and I think Lane and Susan would be more than happy to jump in also.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks, Jannine. And kind of what I was thinking was we've still got a little bit of time, and folks are still on, have questions. I think, Kathy, we can allow attendees to raise their hand or even ask a question. We can unmute you and ask a question, right?
Yes, that's correct.
So if anybody has questions, there should be a raise your hand or a chat box, and we can unmute you. Jannine, I've got a question for you. So why is it that the carcass data needs to go through through you guys, and it can't just be uploaded through Herdbook directly?
Well, the major reason for that is it's a way for us to verify where it's coming from, that we can assure the data is accurate, then we're able to make sure the format and everything's correctly, that the system's going to accept the data, and it is just a way we can assure that what we have is legitimate data.
Yeah, that's always been one of those things that I've always felt was valuable to what we're doing, and it's similar to ultrasound data as well, right?
Correct. Yep. And ultrasound is also processed in-house, and again, just assures that validity and making sure that it's approved technicians, etc. Correct.
I am not seeing any questions from the audience. I think we've got Bert.
So if you click on the question mark, the orange one.
There we go. Bert, I think you should be unmuted.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. There's a full blood Fleckvieh herd here in Iowa, and in some of their promotions, why they promote, there's been a lot of carcass data gathered on some of their customers. And I'm planning a visit up to there within the next month. And I'm just wondering if there's I noticed that in that list that there aren't any full bloods. And I just wondered if there's any avenue to, make some suggestions to them if they have an interest. I did forward the link to them. I don't know that they're on, but I did forward the link for this program to see if they were interested as well. But what kind of issues do you see if somebody was interested in using full bloods or a full blood or in this program?
Yeah, that's a really good question, Bert. So I will say, in the past we've had some full blood Fleckvies on that list. Got quite a few records out of them. It's just been a couple years since then, since we've had a nomination. And Jannine and Susan could speak to this as well, but from our experience, the cooperators that we work with You know, they get to choose the bulls, and we certainly try to recommend bulls to make sure that every bull gets sampled. But in some of the herds that we've worked with specifically, using full blood they just haven't wanted to use them as much. And we had a herd that loved to use them for a long time, but they're no longer a cooperative herd with us. Same thing with Simbra bulls. We've had some Simbra nominations in the past, but you know, you're pretty limited to regional herds that want to use those bulls, and so it's just one of those things where when I was helping with the nomination side of thing, you know, I would say let's put the bull on the list, let's get them into the hands of our cooperative herds, and just, you know, see what they think, and certainly encourage. There was a bull on that list that was a purebred Wagyu bull. We put him on the list, and I don't think anybody used him, but he was on the list for quite a while. So we try to be as accommodating as possible to all the bulls that get nominated, and you know, we don't bill any, we don't invoice anything until after the breeding season. So if you know, we've done half tests before, we've done quarter tests, and it's just one of those things where if the you know, if we don't get a full test on them, we're not going to invoice you for a full test. So I'd say, yeah, shoot them Susan's information.
Okay, thanks.
And it looks like John or Logan might have their hands up.
Oh yeah, there we go. So John, I saw you first. I think you're self-muted right now.
Yeah, I put a question in the chat about the carcass data. In the past, I think we filled out a spreadsheet with just the carcass data and sent it on into the CARC. Are you wanting the raw data that we're getting from the plants, or are you wanting that condensed spreadsheet form?
I don't mind that you put it into the condensed spreadsheet form, but if we can get the raw data, one, just to verify and to be able to link it to the original upload, we really do appreciate that. And then it is helpful for us, just if something comes into question, we can go back and check original spreadsheets too.
Great, thank you.
And Logan Wallace, it looks like you had a question mark or on the questions page. So I'm going to try and see if I can find that. But if you want to chime in, I think you should be unmuted as well.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I just had a question. We've had issues with been going to, I think some of the cattle have gone to Tyson. And I know the last load or two, we've had issues with getting carcass data back. One group was just a few we didn't get back from, but there was one that, I don't know, maybe 25%, 30%, we didn't get any carcass data. I didn't know if you had any places in the Iowa area that maybe you've had better luck or worse luck as far as carcass data.
Yeah, look, I appreciate the question, and certainly we've seen not just at that plant, but at others as well. So are they, I'm curious, is it due to like EID read failures, or is it due?
I believe it's the EID read failure for the most part. I know that. Or that's, I think that's what the, where the other farm that feeds the cattle had said was a lot of the EIDs didn't get read.
Gotcha. Yeah. And honestly, there's nothing that we can do there, right? I mean, once those cattle have been harvested, unless they've got somebody on the line for tag transfer, we're never going to be able to recover those data. We've had that issue a couple times the last couple years. So okay. Part of that, I think, is, the EID readers there have a tendency to fail, And then also we've got multiple frequency tags that, you know, maybe bouncing off some of those readers. I don't know the exact cause, but in the Iowa area, I've heard that they're going to build some new plants, which is exciting nearby.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's not just that one location, to be honest.
Okay. Well, we.
Logan. This is Jannine. Hey, you wouldn't by chance know if, have you ever checked with them to see if they prefer a certain EID or not? Because I've, in the past, we've had that some readers just don't read certain brands as well as others. So that would be a question I have that you might check, because I know in the past that's been an issue. So it might not hurt if you have no other options to see if that would make a difference.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, I don't see any more questions coming through the chat box. Oh, never mind. I see Jerry Brink, you have your hand up. I'm going to unmute you. You should be able to chime in.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. On collecting that data, how much raw data do as a participant, if we would consign a bull to the research, how much data do we get? Do we get raw data back, or do we just get indexes and EPDs back on the progeny?
Yeah, that's a good question. So if you nominate a bull, we will provide back the raw data if you ask for it. But we don't publish that anywhere in our publications or in our reports. But that can be something that if you wish to get individual data back, we can't send it back on those calves. What we do is, to your point, the data does go into the genetic evaluation. And so you'll see a pretty significant increase in accuracy for those carcass EPDs and then, you know, and the corresponding indexes. And really that's where the most value comes, you know, from a genetic evaluation perspective, is improving those accuracies. But yes, absolutely, if you nominate the bull, we can provide individual carcass data closeouts as well.
Is everything pretty well set up as a terminal, or is there some maternal evaluation generations later that you stay in touch with the cooperators on?
Yeah, that's a good question as well. So, you know, John, he just tuned in. You know, we've been doing work with them for years now. And so there's probably some females out of CMP bulls from years past that are still in THE and they're still recording calves and they're still being involved with reporting performance data. And so, yeah, there's definitely maternal metrics that feed back into the genetic evaluation just because of that relation, that long-term relationship with our cooperative herds as well. So yeah, absolutely. It's actually one of the most important parts about our relationship with the cooperative herd is to make sure that we can, you know, keep in touch and keep feeding those maternal traits as well.
Okay, so we have full blood Fleck V cattle, and Bert had made a comment there. What percent? I mean, if you're trying to get people to use full bloods, which they aren't around every corner, do you hope to get? I mean, what percentage of the population do we need to have in order to get any validity out of it?
So are you asking about contemporary group size, like how many animals in a contemporary group need to be Fleck V versus purebred bulls?
Well, I'm not sure. You made a comment earlier exactly how many herds you have, but I mean, if you have, say, you have 20 cooperator herds and maybe there's only five guys that would consider a full blood, will that be enough to get a fair evaluation?
I see what you're saying. Yep. So, I mean, the best place to start would be to get those in a single contemporary, because really that's where you're going to get the most value. And I may have said this earlier, but what, you know, what Susan and I in the past have tried to do is make sure that every bull that's nominated gets in at least two herds, but prefer that each bull gets into three. So that way you can spread those genetics across multiple contemporary groups. And then within those contemporary groups, you have some variation between sire groups. And so really that's where we try to put the most effort. Not every bull is going to be in every single herd, right? So we try to get each bull in a minimum of two. And so in the case of your question, if we got a Fleck V bull, you know, into the program and some of our herds used them, then, you know, we would have some comparisons there within, you know, a couple different contemporary groups. And that alone will provide enough value on that bull.
Yeah. And how many bulls are you using per herd on an average?
It depends on the size of the herd. It can range from a minimum of four to, you know, six, seven, eight bulls, depending on the size. You know, we try to make sure that it's a minimum of four, though, because we're not using reference sires in these designed breeding schemes, we have to use multiple young sires to build up the accuracy. And the reason why we don't use reference sires is because there's a limited number of cows in the program per year, and we'd rather get as much information out of proving young bulls as, you know, instead of continually proving proven bulls. So,
okay, we have some commercial herds that are using our bulls, and the bulls they are using have already been DNA'd. And if we are able to get data, carcass data back on those progeny out of those DNA'd bulls, that can be, how do you handle that data? It won't be through the cooperator program, but just walk me through that procedure of how you handle that data if we're able to get some.
Yeah, so I think, so we should probably visit again, Jerry, just because it sounds like you've got a pretty neat opportunity. But the way that it sounds like is if a commercial herd has them genotypes, so cows and sires, the way that that would function, and Jannine would probably know better than I would here, but those we could possibly enroll those calves through our total enrollment option C program and just link those back to sire and dam via genotypes. But that might take a pretty robust conversation with, you know, maybe off the call, to be honest. Sounds like you got something going on.
Okay, that's fine. I'll follow up with that later. Then I just, yeah, we might have options to get some raw data back on our bulls from non-cooperator herds. And so those herds, if we're going to use that data, then those cows need to be in your system if we're going to enter that data then.
Yes. Yep. Yep. We need a sire and we need a dam in our system in order to link them back through pedigree.
So, okay. Yep. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you. Very cool. Jacob Hauk, I believe, has your hand up. I've unmuted you. I think you should be able to tune in.
So I have two questions, I guess. So the first question is, so you just said that you need four or a minimum of four sires per herd to make it unbiased. But so if I have just a solid or a red herd and I only want to use red bulls, you only had one red bull on that list. I mean, is it possible to get others, or would I have to use a black bull as well, or what are your thoughts there?
That's a good question. So yeah, we would try to try to help you find some more Red Bulls, to be honest. One of the things that we can do, so we've got a pretty sizable backlog of Red Bulls in our program. And so if, you know, there was three bulls that we had on the list or two bulls that we had on the list that worked for you, and we had one that was, you know, from the year before, we could certainly do that. You know, we try to be as flexible as possible, to be honest. And we try to make it work for your program. And if black calves just flat don't work, then, you know, I'd say that we try not to get in the way of that.
Okay. And then my second question, maybe some of the other cooperators that are on the call can maybe answer this too, but so we've retained ownership in our calves for the last couple of years, not obviously in the CMP program, but it seems to me that we've had some not very many packers want to give us the, you know, or go to the effort to get the carcass information back to us. So what have you guys found, you know, one buyer that's more willing to get that information, or do you guys, you know, use only one buyer or one plant or, you know, certain plants, or what are you guys doing?
Yeah, that's a good point. Jannine, would you have an understanding of how many plants we receive data from? I don't know it off the top of my head.
Not off the top of my head. I know probably four. The one that we get the most data from typically is Chapel out of Nebraska, and they absolutely love our Carcass Merit calves, and they've been the most cooperative. And I know that I've got a couple other breeders that submit carcass data, and they've got a couple plants that do really well also. I would have to look up company names to figure out some of those, but I do know that Chapel is one that we've shared with a lot of people just because they have been so good to work with.
Okay.
So, I mean, it varies based off of who you're working with. There's a lot of cattle buyers. There's a lot of feedlots that have, you know, pretty firm relationships with packers. And so it's basically the reason why carcass data is so difficult to get into the evaluation. So it's why, you know, ASA spends considerable amount of time and effort trying to get their hands on data to put into the eval. And so you're very, you know, aware of those struggles that a lot of folks that we work with have. And so, it's from my experience, there are cattle buyers that are more receptive to carcass data sharing than others. But I will say selling cattle cash is probably not the way to go. If you can get those calves on a grid, usually it's a lot easier to get the carcass data back because you're taking that risk, right? And so, cash cattle is usually the best way to not get carcass data back from a packer. But, you know, finding the relationships with feeders who, you know, believe in carcass data is paramount. And Jannine mentioned Chapel, who we've been working with, you know, for the last couple of years and love that relationship. There are others. We work with a range of other feedlots and packers, but that one's been one of the best relationships for us.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. So I see two questions that popped up. One from Jamie Nelson asking if we can send a copy of the Carcass Merit Program explanation. And certainly if Susan doesn't get that sent to you, I'll pipe in as well and try to get it sent over ASAP. And then Heidi, is it Pieper or Piper, asks, what plant did we mention from Nebraska? It's Chapel, Chappell, I believe, in Western Nebraska. So Tom Williams there. Very cool. Do we have other questions? If not, please feel free to reach out to any one of us. Direct all CMP questions to Susan. And yeah, I appreciate everybody hopping on. It's been a great hour, and I hope this helped answer some questions regarding the Carcass Merit Program and the American Simmental Association's various carcass efforts. So, Jannine or Susan, do you have anything to add? Otherwise, I think we can call it a night.
The only thing I would add is just the fact that for any of you, if you've got herds that could be potential candidates for either being a CMP herd or sires that are out there, that we would love to reach out to them. It is certainly no obligation, or it's not mandatory, but those who are collecting the data that are really proactive and progressive breeders, we would love to be able to work with them.
Awesome. This is Susan. Yeah, and I've already got Jamie's email, so I've got that fired up. She'll get it here in just a few minutes. And anybody else that wants information, we'll be glad to try to provide it to get us started.
Great. Thank you so much, everybody. We'll tune in and sign off, but appreciate everybody. And yeah, keep us posted on any and all carcass opportunities. Thank you all.